Democratic change. I thank you and I congratulate you upon that valor that you have demonstrated. Last night, I heard Mr. Museveni concerned that some NRM members were assaulted during the youth elections. And he was charging, we shall not allow this, we shall crash. Shame on him. He has never known how many of our people have been terrorized, tortured, and beaten. He has never known. And killed who are in their graves. When the Kiboko squad was descending from Central Police Station, did he beat beasts or taxpayers that account for his luxury of the money they steal with impunity? And he's worried that some NRM people are beaten by other citizens. When we are tortured by people, we pay our money. So thank you. Thank you for remaining firm. Liberating a country is not easy. Thank you for being there and for saying no to those rogues that control our country today. I would like to inform you that, you know, that struggle which I joined to fight gunmen has taken various phases to get where we are. And if we want to get to where we are going, we must understand where we are coming from. Accumulated is not experience that is useless. It's experience we must build on to take us forward. I started the struggle myself through armed fighting, through holding guns and fighting. And I can tell you, therefore, the war we fought, which has been totally desecrated and turned into the most disastrous thing that our country could have had, was a just war that we went to. We went to a just war to fight for our freedom. Fighting for freedom is the most noble and just cause. Every person that is created by God is given right to freely exist like any other person. It's not granted, it is only granted by God. So when you take away my freedom, I must fight for it. And we went and fought with guns. And as a result of that war, 500,000 people perished during that struggle. But yes, freedom has a cost. We did not lament because we thought it was a just cause leading us to freedom. But as you know, as soon as we got into government in 1986, these rogues now calling themselves a government turned around and did 100 times worse than the people that we had fought. And some of us protested, said we could not have risked our lives in order to do worse than those we were fighting. Because me, I was never a politician. I was a medical doctor. The reason I went and spent years hungry, sleeping with mosquitoes and all kinds of animals was not for a person, it was for my freedom. It was for the freedom of Uganda. So when our colleagues betrayed that struggle, some of us rejected and started right away challenging them. And some of you have not been around to see those different phases that we went through. 2001 election. Even in 2001, I was not really meant to be a candidate. I became a candidate by circumstances, just the last hour. Because I was retired from the military in October, and that October I became a candidate for an election in February. But was a major turning point in what was going on. It is still the most violent election we have had in Uganda up to today. Many people died, many were wounded and so on, arrested, terrorized. That time there were no parties. Parties were not allowed to sponsor candidates. Everybody was an individual. I stood in the election of 2001 as an individual. There was nothing else. People who rose up to support me were just supporting elect Kano Kiza Besigye. That was all. There was no organization. But our people fought, and through that fight, some changes happened. Because even in spite of having only 3 months, I believe we won that election, 2001. And we went to court. The court confirmed that there was widespread cheating and there was no free and fair election. Court in its unanimous judgment, there were 5 judges then in 2001. All the 5 said this was not a free and fair election. And they listed all the terrible things that happened. Unfortunately, when it came to the most important thing of deciding whether that election should be cancelled, again, because of some weaknesses, the court was divided in the middle, 3-2. 3 judges voted to uphold that sham election. Because that is subjective, it's not based on any yardstick. It is each judge to decide subjectively after making all the findings and so on, each judge subjectively. And we know what influences those subjective changes. So 3-2, they upheld the election. The violence continued until I ran out of the country. I spent 4 years in South Africa. FDC was formed when I was in South Africa. And the leaders of FDC thought that I could still come back and help in the struggle of that period. And I accepted and came back in 2005 October for the election in February. I was nominated here. The Electoral Commission came here to register me on my way from Entebbe. On the 26th of October, that's when they registered me as a voter here for an election. I think that time it was on the 11th of February. And then 2 weeks later, on the 14th of November, he was arrested and charged with rape, with treason, with terrorism, with illegal possession of guns. You who had just arrived and sent to Luzira. I was given bail from Luzira. The court was attacked and said, you cannot get out. Stayed in Luzira with bail, but not able to get out. I was eventually nominated from Luzira as a candidate. I got bail in January for the election in February. And even after coming out of jail, I was in court being tried for rape up to the election time. But our people fought. FDC had just been formed, it had weak structures in the country. But our people fought extremely hard. And I am sure we won that election. Many people have said so, including those who were on the other side. All these people who desert, that's what their first message is. By the way, you won. Why didn't you say when you were still there? We went to court. Same as 201, everybody confirmed. That time there were seven judges. All seven judges confirmed this election is not free and fair. This is a record that will never be wiped away. A record on the election of Uganda. It's there. For you, anybody can go and read it. Seven judges unanimously, this election is not free and fair. You read the constitution. The constitution allows only one election in Uganda, a free and fair election. But even after writing it in their judgment that this is not free and fair, they failed to cancel it. Even in 2006, it was a divided court, 4-3. Four judges saying they should keep it, three judges saying it should be canceled. And the election stood. From 2006, but after the 2001 election, part of that struggle is what caused the return of multi-party elections. Because when Museveni got scared of the challenge from within NRM, those who were here, you may remember his missives. He said basically did not consult our organs. So then it became organs to decide the candidates. And all these, his mistakes are what were taken by Mulodi here and his the Honorable Paul Kawanga Semogerere, who led the petition. They compiled all the evidence and took it to court. And the court said, no, this is not a no-party system, it's a one-party system, which is not allowed. And that's how we got parties to function. So every election, though it does not lead us to where we are, it adds on something. So in 2006, when all that happened, those of us who were here decided that now, in the past two elections, we have only had 3 months to prepare. Now we have 5 years to prepare. So let us have no excuse whatsoever. Let's go and prepare for an election. Because really what we wanted was that we give a chance to orderly electoral transfer of power. Orderly, as provided in the law. That's what we wanted to give the regime a chance to do. To step down in an orderly way. But that they abused. So in 2011, we had enough time I went to every sub-county of Uganda between 2006 and 2011. And in many sub-counties, I went to many parishes of those sub-counties. We rebuilt the structures of FDC from the grass up to the top. That's why we had an early delegates conference in 2009. My first term as leader of FDC lasted only 4 years. The reason was that we didn't want to go with shaky structures to 2011. So we built from the grassroots up to the top. And in 2009, we had a delegates conference to re-elect national leaders. That's the first time I contested with General Mundu. So we went to 2011 prepared. We even fundraised and paid nomination fees for every candidate of FDC, from the grassroots up to the top. We paid lawyers' fees for those who needed affidavits and whatever. We paid everything and even printed posters for some of our candidates. We ran a very strong campaign in 2011. Of all the four elections that I have participated in, what the Electoral Commission has been giving me, which is fake, that is when they gave me the least votes in 2011. Of all the four, that's when I got the least. What they read out was the least that I have ever got. Much less than when I had only three months and no structures. So in 2011, we realized we need now to shift the gear. From just looking for orderly electoral transfer of power to now really fighting for our right and our power. Are we together? So a gear changed in 2011. And that's when we started walk to work. Remember? 4G, CFOC. At that stage, I also realized that leading FDC alone and being busy with FDC work would not help that struggle that we had engaged. Because that struggle needs a lot of time. It needs everyone who is oppressed, not just those of FDC. Everybody who is oppressed must be part of that struggle. And so in 2012, I asked my colleagues here to allow me to step down as a leader of FDC. 3 years to the end of my term. We had a lot of debate. There were emotions like I was seeing here this morning. Saying, how can you leave the leadership of FDC? But I explained that we are not in FDC for the sake of FDC. We are in FDC to liberate ourselves, Uganda. And FDC and those non-FDC, we must see how to liberate this country. And as I told you, that gear we engaged in 2011 of struggle, fighting, could not be done just as a party activity. It had to be done by all, whether you have a party, whether you don't have a party. If you are oppressed, we hold each other's hand and we advance. So I stepped down. after a lot of struggle also here, and a new party leader was elected. Some indeed thought I was leaving the struggle. They were saying he has abandoned. Kala tulese wakati mnyanja. Never. I can never. I just changed the position. And that's why, especially you fighters, you must be flexible. If you are fighting from this position and the enemy identifies where you are, they are going to concentrate the fire where you are. You must therefore never stay in one position for a long time. You change cover. You must change cover. Change cover. They must not predict what you are doing or where you are. So, in 2012, I stepped out of Najanankumbi. That's why I was extremely happy. Many people, especially out there, the loudspeakers of the rogue regime, we are predicting doom. And now Besigye has gone, FDC is finished. He's finished. Is it weaker or it's stronger?
Stronger!
Stronger. But the struggle outside is also stronger. So yes, we went out. I was fighting shoulder to shoulder with the Lord Mayor. He was not a member of FDC. We've been fighting shoulder to shoulder with many people who are not necessarily members of FDC. And that's what makes the struggle much stronger. I had actually said that even in 2016, I would not go to the election of 2016. When these processes were going on, I was out of the country, but I had not left the struggle. And I would not want to reveal on this occasion what attracted me to come back in 2016. It was not because my assessment of what elections do had changed, no. But I made an assessment together with our colleagues that there was a greater danger that we needed to deal with, which at an opportune time we shall have the freedom to talk about. Now, in 2016, because of those reasons, I came back to the election. But now I came back with both gears. Are we together?
Yes.
With the gear of the struggle and the gear of the election, the campaigns for elections. And that's why some of you who listened to my message during the campaigns or the message of our party, we were telling Ugandans that actually the country they were talking about getting a leader for was not in their hands. That the country is not in their hands. This country is not in the hands of Ugandans. It's in the hands of the gunmen that captured it and who use it arrogantly, act with impunity, still with impunity. I don't think this country will ever have looters or plunderers like these plunderers led by Mr. Museveni. It has never happened. These billions they are now squandering here, they just stole from borrowed money for COVID. They are using COVID money to rent support. So in 2016, as I said, we did not go into the election as usual. We went into the election with the two gears. We prepared our people throughout the campaign. We prepared our people to fight. And there is absolutely no doubt about the support of the people of Uganda that we got in 2016. Even foreigners, even locals, even NRM, they know that we defeated Museveni flat in the elections. They came here, raided headquarters, kept it solely for themselves for 3 weeks. They were the ones in charge of our headquarters for 3 weeks. They had hoped to capture the declaration forms that we had got in 2011. And they captured a few. But I can assure you, without the slightest form of doubt, that the greatest majority of the declaration forms of 2016 are in our possession. And that's why, and we can use what we have in our possession to demonstrate to anybody that it is us who won that election. And that's why we were demanding an audit in 2016. Even some foreigners offered to audit the election so that we give them our evidence and whoever else challenges us brings theirs. Our friends, the Swedes, stepped in to help. We even signed the memorandum agreeing to audit, which is in our possession, the memorandum for audit of the 2016 elections. Then Mr. Museveni knew that we were now pressing him against the wall. He chickened out. Said, I'm no longer interested. Even after he himself had also signed, accepting an audit. So there is no doubt that Mr. Museveni is totally illegitimate as the leader of this country. As you know, they took me to jail, charged me with treason for declaring myself a winner. And I went to court and said, yes, it's true, I declared myself, here I am. Try me. Let me show you that it is I indeed who won. That's why I declared myself. It's now 5 years. We are going into another election. They have never tried me. I am still a prisoner on treason. Never tried. Because they don't want the truth to come out. And since 2016, then the desperate Mr. Museveni has been rampaging all over the place. He then created the new electoral commission, this one. He created it while not supposed to be in office himself. This Lyabakama commission itself is illegitimate because it was set up by an illegitimate man. who has continued to tamper with it. Even in the middle of this particular election, Mr. Museveni has sacked some of the electoral commission senior staff. Museveni attacked Kasese. That was election violence because we had humiliated him in Kasese. Even with their cheating and whatever, the gallant fighters of Rwenzururu, of the Banyarwenzururu in Kasese, fought and took every elected position there. He knew this was a bad example and went and attacked Kasese. The king of the Banyarwenzururu is still in prison here in Kampala. From 2016, hundreds of the people of Kasese are in jail up to now. Hundreds are in mass graves in Kasese. That's 2016. He did not stop there. We were lucky the country was given a bonus when the Americans arrested a man that brought bribes to them, a man called Chi Ping Ho. The money he brought was also for elections. The evidence is there in part of what he was tried for in the court. The evidence is there that he was contributing to an election. Bribe from the Chinese man. Kutesa, who took the bribe, is still our Minister of Foreign Affairs, painting shame wherever he goes in the world. Then, Mr. Museveni would not be on the ballot today if it was not for the attack on Parliament. Because the Constitution wouldn't allow him to be there. He took forces, that's why I say it's the gun rule. Took the military into Parliament under the clear view of all your cameras. And that's how we have now a new constitution. When the whole country was singing Toji Kwatako, I am glad that the Judah Iscariot Majesi seems to have been hounded out of his village. I hope all those who similarly betrayed the country can be hounded out of whoever. They are the enemies of our country. Since then, that's how Mr. Museveni now took money from government to go and campaign to be a Soro candidate. Parliament gave him, I think it was 50 billion to go and campaign for Soro candidate, 50 billion. They were paying every NRM person who appeared 100,000 shillings. Was it 300? Trust the Ugandans, at least they shared into that because they would wait outside the meeting and grab it from them. So that is how we have come to where we are. Now for us in 2016, when I came out of jail, together with our colleagues here, we decided to now strengthen the struggle platform by forming the People's Government. The People's Government has been working day and night with one task, to end the illegitimate hold of power by Mr. Museveni and the rogue government he leads. That is the mission of the People's Government. And we have worked, I can assure you, we have worked hard all these 5 years. There have also been some interferences with our work, some from the regime, some from outside the regime. But we have withstood them and remained focused on where we are going. So, ladies and gentlemen, we are at another crossroads. When the junta, the gunmen, are organizing another election to legitimize themselves, that's what they are doing. I told you that in 2016,